Dr. Marangu Njogu will now give the convocation address.
The President of the University of Guelph, members of the faculty and the students, distinguished guests, it is indeed a very special honor to receive an honorary doctorate degree from the prestigious University of Guelph. I do so knowing that it is not only personal achievement that you are recognizing, but also it is a reaching out to the many people labeled as refugees. The refugees are human beings with human need and entitled to human rights. Oftentimes, the labor is depriving and also demeaning to the individual. It makes refugees feel inadequate, and sometimes the power of the labor takes away the passion and abilities to live to their full potential as human beings. I believe this award is also a gesture to draw the attention of other universities on the existence of enormous refugee intellectuals that can contribute to the world peace. If honest, there are 2 refugee camps in Kenya hosting over 300,000 refugees. The refugees have been to these camps since early 1990s. About 50% of them are from, about 50% of the 55 refugees are from Sudan, and 98% of 300 refugees are from Somalia. Their dream to return home has been threatened by the continued crisis in their countries. The case for the Dadaab is more severe because of the current situation and the clashes between the transitional federal government and the militia. The protracted nature of the Dadaab refugee casehood has fatigued donors. The per capita of the funding to support camp activities has diminished with each year from 2 fronts: the increasing refugee population and funding that has remained static. With the reduction in general funding, education suffers most. Although education is a human right, lack of it is not seen as a threat to life. Then, this notwithstanding, higher level education for the refugees has never been given a priority. We all know that university and college education is a cradle of human resource development in every country. For Kenya refugees, education situation, every year as many as 4,000 refugee children complete primary education with great hope of continuing to secondary school. However, only about 1,000 are absorbed by the camp-based secondary schools. This means about 300,000 students are not able to continue with education, but abruptly graduate into the end of life in the camps. Of the 1,000 who are able to go to secondary schools, only 600 qualify for the middle level education. USC, on average, takes about 40 students to Canada. One of these students, our friend Orono Orono, is now the deputy prosecutor of the UN tribunal in Arusha for the Rwanda genocide. About more than about another 100 students get scholarship to pursue their higher education in Kenya through support of other organizations. Then this leaves about 400 secondary school graduates qualified to go to universities, again graduating into the idle life in the camps. For these young people, they view their lack of support to continue to universities as an abandonment at the time their appetite for education is highest. And this can be perilous. The Dadaab is just 80 kilometers from the Kenyan border, Kenya-Somali border. What would prevent such frustrated young people from being lured into the world of piracy where they can earn millions of money, or by the militia into the army where they can continue to fight their government? Young people taking themselves to be abandoned would easily develop negative perception about the world. They are joining the militia or piracy could as well be on a revenge mission. The world might not see it this way now, and it may also not link pirates and militia to this feeling of abandonment. But the reality might come to haunt the world one day when the desire to reverse the situation might be painfully expensive in terms of human and capital loss, as well as accumulated negative perception about the world by such young people. Education is a fundamental human right, but it is also a powerful tool to positively transform people and bring people together. It leads to improved living conditions, productive citizenship, self-development, and ownership and control of one's life. In the refugee camps, students of different nationalities and clans and tribes stand under one roof. The long time education keeps them together, particularly in primary and secondary, helps them to start appreciating each other and eventually to appreciate their diversity as human beings. There is a general pride in academic achievement and progression. When students go to the university, those in primary and secondary schools are inspired and see university students as their role models. When bright